went to schools in, so I can tell people I'm born, bred and buttered in Nigeria. I went to schools, Kikotun Memorial School, Adebola Baptist High School, Mayflower Ikenne, the University of Lagos. I did my master's here at the Pan-Atlantic University, Pan-African University. And I came out of school, I had written, during my WAEC exams, I had written a book called His Father's Knickers. My publisher didn't understand how to publicize brands and products in Lagos. When I got back, I was a couch potato, so I knew everything about television and media. And so when I finished school, I'd written my exams, I had my, I think, 6 month break or 4 month break, I'm not sure. So I came to Lagos and I began to publicize things by myself. I began to go to TV stations, I'd go to NTA Channel 10, I'd wait for Femi Yondaskar to come in, I'd go and meet her, I have this book. I went to a recording of Insider with Agatha, I went to meet Agatha, I had this book. So that's just generally how I met people. I began talking about my book, and I wanted to share my book and my story in the book with the world. And that's how I got my first job. I was on the Sunday show. The Sunday show was anchored by a late legend called Livia Jonoma. And he had the longest running independently produced TV show in the country at the time. And he was interviewing me about my book, and then suddenly he said to his audience, "Look, what do you think? This guy is smart. Let's give him a segment on the show." And that's how I began to present a youth segment on NTA Channel 10 in the year 2000. And that's how my media journey started. 1 year after, Fumi Yonda offered me a job after appearing on her show as a researcher for New Dawn with Fumi on NTA 10. Then he went on NTA Network, and I moved from there. I went to work for a reality show called The Academy. Then I worked for a TV drama called The Station. Then I worked for True Love West Africa. Then you know how that goes. I worked for. I did some work for Big Brother magazine, all of that. And so that's how it's been, really. It's just been climbing the ladder step by step over the past 16 years. And I tell people that I didn't want to be an entrepreneur. And even these days, I wake up some mornings and I wonder what the hell I'm doing. I became an entrepreneur by accident, purely by accident. I was working for... I'd already begun to build brands from when I was in 2005 when we started building the Future Awards Africa. So I was doing it on the side, but I never thought I would be an entrepreneur. But really, I was trying to solve a problem. And now, I wouldn't have put it that way then, but I looked at the media and they were not, and you know, it's very easy now, everybody has what, Accelerate TV, they have Ebony Live TV, they have Beat FM, Urban, Sound City, everything. Then, we had what, NTA, NBI, NTA 2, NTA 10, NTA 7. Media, there was no brand managers, companies didn't have youth segments. There was absolutely nothing like youth media, and the youth wasn't taken seriously as a market, as a demographic. But also, those of us, I was working in the media at the time, my co-founder, Adebola, was working in the media at the time, and we just kind of felt that there was a gap for young people in the media space. And we didn't just want to create yet another media platform. We wanted something that would actually add value to the lives of young people. So from the beginning, we had a clarity of vision. We're going to inspire young people. We're going to inspire. The target audience was going to be young people. And the tool we're going to use was going to be the media. So even for us, our first product, which was the Future Awards, is essentially a media product. You know, the Future Awards is, how do you build a brand that is so attractive to the media that we use that to inspire mass audiences of young people? And so for me, it was just, I would hear so many stories in the press, young people are 419ers, young people are trying to leave the country, young people are leaving Edo State to go to Italy, all those kinds of stereotypes. And I saw a different type of young person in my day-to-day work. They were opening businesses, they were building NGOs, even if they were modeling. You know, modeling used to have a bad rap then, and people used to think that models were prostitutes. And you will see that these young models were not prostitutes, they were trying to build an actual career that has global potential. And so I and my co-founders wanted to tell that story. And obviously, the only way we could have done that was to do it ourselves, because people didn't understand at that time what we were trying to do. And so we became entrepreneurs by default, because the only way we could solve that problem was to become entrepreneurial. Initial challenges when I began to run the business, first of course is funds, financing. You know, we started this business with zero naira. People think I'm being metaphorical when I say that. It's not a metaphor. Literally zero naira. We literally started by not using money, by using goodwill, by using rented crouch, borrowing an office space with a Efere Ozako in Yaba, using his computer, because we didn't have computers at the time. So we didn't have an account. We didn't have one naira that was invested into this business. And so that was the first challenge, to find the funds to even do the things you wanted to do, which was also a blessing, because now I don't really regret it. I wouldn't do it differently, because not having money teaches you what to do when you do have money, and it teaches you what is possible, and you don't waste, and you're not careless, and you're certainly not reckless when you eventually have a little bit of money. So that was the hugest challenge. And the second challenge was to be taken seriously as a young person. It's very easy these days to be taken seriously as a young person, as a scriptwriter, as a producer. When I was young, you know, I was producing a show for 2 years. It was difficult for the CEO to call me producer. It was so hugely difficult. She couldn't think of how do you call a 19-year-old a producer? The real challenge 16 years ago was how to be taken seriously as a young person. I find it very difficult to advise people because because my story, at least, like somebody asked me the other day, how do I keep going when I have challenges? And I said, you just keep going. And I could see him disappointed because he wanted me to tell him something profound, like you reach vitalize. I don't, you know, all we've done is to keep going. When we face challenges, we are certain about the vision. This is what we want to do. This is why we want to do it. This is the target audience, is it? And that's what we've done. So the Buhari campaign, for instance, there wasn't a competitive, well, there was a competitive bidding to the extent that other people had spoken to them about handling their accounts. But we didn't even know that they were looking for an agency. Somebody simply said, look, you guys have done this thing for 10 years, the Future Awards. You guys run Y Niger. You guys certainly know, and you guys run a PR company. So you guys certainly know how to reach young people when it comes to governance. He said, I can't think of anybody else who can do this. And he didn't even know that we had a governance communication company called Statecraft. He didn't even know that that was part of our vision. This is something we had formed about a year before. And so really, the way we got it was we just kept doing our work and letting the world see what we do.